Hello everyone. Today in this session, I am again here with a new current affairs for your social justice paper. Again, it is a part of your GS2 and the issue is about again a health issue. So it's, as I said in the previous videos also, like this health issue is, it's been current affairs for frequently and with different themes, different dimensions that we have, you know, covered in our previous videos, like Gorakhpur tragedy or national health policy, Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, or, you know, this time here we'll be discussing about the Mental Health Care Act 2017. So this is a new act, you know, about the, for the mental illness, you know, the people who are suffering from mental illness. So this act, you know, it is one of the, considered as the, one of the most progressive act, you know, under the government, because it is considered as one of the most progressive act at this point of time, because it has replaced the Mental Health Act 1987, which had many loopholes and which was, you know, insufficient to take care of the mental ill patients. So it was this act, it is very progressive and it's very individualistic in the nature, because it is empowering the patient, it is focusing and giving rights to the people with, you know, suffering from mental illness. So here we'll see, you know, from the examination point of view, what is important here is that you might, you know, there is a most probable chance that you might get a case studies based on this mental illness health. And of course, in your GS2 part under the health issue, this topic has become very, very important. So let's see here what are the main provisions of this act. You know, before discussing the main provisions, the bill has given, the act has given some definition about whom should we cover, you know, whom should we call mentally ill, right, or mentally ill person. So here we'll be seeing the definition. According to the act defines mental illness as, it is a substantial disorder of thinking, mood, perception, orientation, or memory that grossly impairs judgment, behavior, capacity to recognize reality, or the ability to meet the ordinary demands of the life. Mental conditions associated with the abuse of alcohol and drugs, but it does not include the mental retardation, you know. So this is one kind of, you can say that it is one of the loopholes, because it is not considering the mental retardation as a, you know, a kind of mental illness. But the, you know, the bill or the act, it defines mental illness as something like, there has to be a substantial disorder in the way of thinking, how the patient or the, how the individual is thinking, or if it is under the, you know, the control, or if it is an under the addiction of some drug or some chemicals. So it is all these things, or if he, you know, he is losing out his memory or his orientation, what is his perception, what he thinks about, how he behaves in the, you know, the social arenas. So all these things, they have been considered and they have got a place in this act, and that makes the act very, very unique. Let's see the other provisions of this act. The provisions of the act mainly includes, first, it gives rights of persons with mental illness. It gives, you know, many rights we'll be seeing. And these are the most crucial thing from your examination point of thing, because it has, you know, it has replaced Mental Health Act 1987, which had many loopholes. So this act, like the first, it is giving right to access to mental health care and treatment. You know, this act gives right to every individual who are suffering from some kind of psychological problems, you know, they have a right for the treatment. The other is about the free treatment for such persons if they are homeless. You know, there it will be free treating the, they have a right to get free treatment, they have a right to get free medicines in terms if they are suffering from these mental illness, or they have this is one of the very crucial point, because this act has recognized that even the persons with having or suffering from some mental illness, they also have a right to live with dignity. And this is one of the very, very core area that you must not forget about this act. Like, they have also life to live with dignity, you know, since they are mostly suffering from this social stigma of being mentally ill or mentally retarded. So this act, it gives them also the right to live with dignity. The other is that right to confidentiality. Anything about their medication, their treatment, or about their mental health, it has to be, you know, kept confidential by the family also. They have a right for this confidentiality, or if they are taking treatment under any medical professional or any hospital or public health services or private health services, it is their right to get all this status, the status of their mental health, a confidential thing. Then other is about photograph or any other information related to the patient. It should not be, you know, it can't be posted on social media, or it can't be made public. And that is also, and that too without their consent. So it has also become one of the important core point or the objective under this. And it is the other is like not to be subjected to electroconvulsive therapy without the use of muscular relaxants or anesthesia. So it is also earlier what used to happen, you know, the doctors, they used to ruthlessly or sometime, you know, without taking proper care, they used to use this electroconvulsive therapy for the mentally ill people. But now it is like they must be properly, you know, diagnosed with this, and then with proper care this treatment has to be given. Then other is like the sterilization will not be performed on such persons. There is no forced or compelled sterilization can be done for these persons. Then not to be changed in any other manner. They have a right, since they have a right to live with dignity. This shows that they can't be chained, or, you know, they can't be given a punishment like solitary confinement, or they can't be subjected to seclusion or isolation, because they also have now got the right to have a live with or dignify or have a dignified life. And one of the main provisions of other, you know, this was the right given to all the mentally ill people. So these rights, at least remember 3-4 core rights here, like they have a right to live with dignity, about their confidentiality, about their free treatment, you know, even like free treatment to the people who are below poverty line, or right to access to mental health care and treatment. So all these things, you know, at least 4-5 core points, it's very, very important for your writing answer. No need to remember whole thing, at least remember 4-5 things that will be useful while writing your answer. Other provisions are that this issue, you know, this act gives provisions for a establishment of a mental health authority. You know, it gives provisions for establishment of a mental health authority. There has to be at this mental establishment of this authority has to be at two levels, one at the central level and other at the state level. So, you know, at both these levels, the authority regarding mental state health, mental health authority has to be, you know, established at these two levels, so that they could take care of the people of that area who are mentally ill. And even they could have a control over what kind of treatment is going, what are the facilities they have been given. So all these, and to what extent they are getting their proper right. So that is, you know, all these things will be taken care of by this authority. Then there is a mental health review board also. There is a provision for establishment of mental health review board, which has, you know, which is established because of to protect the rights of the person with mental illness and manage advance directive. They have to protect the rights of the, so this authority is there to protect the right. Then mental health treatment provision is there, which specifies the process and procedure in which the treatment has to go. So this is all, you, if you see that it is all systemized and very, you know, in a better way, step by step rules and regulations are all formalized and systemized in this new act. That makes it a very important act in that way. Then one of the other core provisions of this act is that it has decriminalized suicide. You know, this is again a very, very good, a historic move in the present scenario, because suicide was a criminal act under Indian Penal Code till now. But this act, the Mental Health Act of 2017, it has decriminalized suicide. Now the people who are suffering or who are attempting suicide, they will be thinking, they will be thought of that they are suffering from some stress, a severe stress, or, you know, severe depression, or, you know, they have that stress. So the earlier times when it was, you know, they used to be punished for that or imprisoned for that. Now they are getting that care. So it is, you can see the attitudinal change, you know, this shows the attitudinal change and the care that is being given to the people who are under depression or under some psychological illness. So that is again one of the core points for this. Other is, you know, there are many positive things. Now, you know, when let's see the what could be the analysis for this act. There are many, you know, so you can see some negatives and some positives are there. The positive point of about this act is that it is very progressive in nature. So you can say it is very progressive in nature in the sense that, you know, it has taken a step or it has gone beyond the previous act of 1987. Because it has, you know, empowered the patient, it has given right to live with a dignity, it has decriminalized suicide, you know, say, so this has gone beyond that act which had, and it has tried to meet the, you know, aspirations and expectation, or most importantly, the need of the mentally ill people. So that is, that makes this, you know, act very, very progressive act. The second positive thing about it, this is, it has adhered to the international norms. You know, it is framed under the Convention on the Rights of, you know, it is on the lines of UN, United Nations Human Rights Treaty of, which is called like Convention on Rights of Persons with Disability, which was ratified in India in 2007. Now, since this act through by Indian government, it shows that it is now, you know, following the lines of United Nations Human Rights. So this also shows that it is going to meet the demands of international, or it is going to adhere to the rules of the international norms related to mental health care. Then other good thing about this act is that it is empowering patients. Since I said there are many rights to this, like right to confidentiality, you know, their photographs or, you know, their status of mental health can't be made public or can't be discussed in the public. So all these things that it has empowered patients that they have also a right, you know, it has tried to remove that social stigma attached to the personality of a person with who is suffering from mentally or who is mentally sick or mentally retarded. So, or, and also it gives a legal right for them for the treatment, free right to get treatments. So all this shows that it has empowered the people with mental sickness on a very large scale, to a very larger extent. Then, of course, it has many demerits also, like, you know, it has not focused, you know, it all talks about curity, you know, cure of this sickness mentally, or how the care has to be taken, but it is silent on that how it can be prevented. If you go according to the statistics of the how many people are there who are mentally ill are there, the statistics shows that it has increased from 2.5 crore to 6.25 crore. Means at present scenario, if you see 6.25 crore of the Indian population, they are suffering from one form or other of the mental illness, and also, you know, they are not able to accept this. So this social stigma attached to the people, so there is no say on what could be done to prevent from these mental illness, how we can do, or how the patients or the people who are suffering from this, you know, they can have a, and you can see a, you know, because of this psychiatric problems or the psychological problems or mental problems, these days, like the games like Blue Whale, who are, you know, they are mostly attracting, or they are making the victims only those children who are less mental, you know, their mental stability is not to that extent. So there is a whole need to, you know, so this is one of the core loophole in this, that it has not talked about prevention. It is going for the cure of the sickness, but it has not talked about, or it has become silent on what should be done to prevent that illness. The other challenges you can say is that, you know, the number of psychiatrists, if you say there are 6.25 crore, you know, people who are suffering from this, but if you go for the psychiatrist, even, you know, there is one psychiatrist for 4,000 people. So it is very, very less. We don't have experts in this, or we don't have experts, medical professional who can treat the people with psychological problems or mental problems. So that is another loophole, that is the lack of skilled manpower treating for giving mental health care services. Then again, the common, you know, the common loophole is that there is again, you know, the lack of expenditure. Public expenditure, the government of expenditure on the terms of mental illness is also very, very low. So obviously the infrastructure for the treatment of these peoples, or the care that they need at, you know, at the every stage of the treatment, it will be again, you know, very limited and very restricted. So this is another loophole. But you can't say, because this is one of the, as I said, is a historic step, because the people who were most neglected, because the mentally ill people, they are the most neglected part of the society. They are suffering from some social stigma. Even the people who are mentally, even the family, they don't have the courage to come up and go for the, you know, the treatment, because they think what the people will, or what the society will think of us. So all these things are there, and these rights that are given with, you know, the act has given so many rights to the people. So we hope that these rights are going to, and people are going to utilize these rights in its full spirit. And the most probable solution for this is that it should not be a, you know, paper thing. It should not be only on paper. It should be followed and implemented at each and every level. Not only in city, but also in the rural areas, the scenario is even worse. So the implementation part has to be very, very strong. The government, the central authority, the central mental authority, which has been set up at central and state level, they have to take care of each and the people at the each and every state level, like block level, district level, or village level. So that will make, you know, will make this act a success. Or you know, it will help the people to reduce the stigma towards mentally ill people, and it is a good step towards rehabilitating all those population, giving their dignified life, giving them a kind of free treatment. So all these things, it shows that the act is very progressive, very reformist in nature, and we hope that the implementation of this act or the provision of this act will lead to, you know, a new era of the medical care given to the mentally sick people. So, you know, this is all about this scheme, you know, this act. Now, coming to what you have to note down for your UPSC mains answer writing or for your ethics case study is that focus on the main provisions, five core main provisions of this. That one of the most important is that it has decriminalized suicide. Suicide till date was, you know, it was a criminal offense, but now it has decriminalized. That is a very, very new thing and very important thing about this. And the other rights, like three, four core rights you have to think, you know, you have to remember. Then go for some challenges or some loopholes. You know, the analysis part. This analysis part is very, of every topic, I discuss the analysis part more, because the analysis part will help you to know it in the depth. Because until unless you know the topic in depth, you won't be able to write a very good answer in mains examination. So what is important is that go in analysis part, think about from multidimensional how it is going, you know, what are its positive effects, what are its negative effects. So, you know, the focusing on both pros and cons of every topic will help you to write a multidimensional answer. And that will be, you know, fetch you more good marks. So here, go for, you know, the core, you know, the provisions of the act. Then go for what are the challenges of the act, what are the merits and demerits of the act, and of course go for some solutions. So this is all about the Mental Health Act 2017.